BNPTV.
Hello again, BNPTV. We're in Blackpool. We're with Jeff and Nicola Bruce, whose son has been kidnapped by the state. Now, you might think that's an odd thing to say, kidnapped by the state, but when the local authority comes along when you're 9 months pregnant and says, you should sign this order so that we can take your child, and they say, well, no, we don't want to sign the order. Well, if you don't sign the order, we'll take the child anyway and you won't get to see him. So the very next day after he was born, the authorities came along and took the child from the mother and the father. And the little boy is named Ty Ethan Bruce, and he was taken away from them by the East Ayrshire Council, which is in Scotland. Jeff and Nicola now live in Blackpool. We'll come on to the contact they've had in a few moments, but I'd just like to kind of outline some of the things that have happened. The child is coming up to 3 years of age. They've written to Gordon Brown, David Cameron twice, the Queen twice, several newspapers, and one of them, the Scottish Sun, slammed the phone down on Jeff, saying, you're kidding, these things don't happen. Well, I can assure you these things do happen. So now I'd like to introduce Jeff, and Jeff's going to tell us what happened. Hi, Jeff.
Hi.
Thanks for agreeing to do this discussion. It can't be easy for you, reliving all these things.
It's not. It's been quite a turbulent time. It's really painful as well.
I can imagine. So do you want to just run us through what happened on the 21st of April, which he was born on the Queen's birthday?
Yeah, Ty was born early hours of the morning by cesarean, actually, and we moved straight away, and we had to wait for social workers to come in to sign an agreement before they'd let us have him back. And that took 4 hours in the morning. So for 4 hours, we weren't even allowed to touch him, see him, or have anything to do with him. We even had the police turn up, didn't we?
Yeah.
And we got told that they wouldn't be there. And I turned around to the police and said, what are you doing here? Because we were told that you weren't, there was no need for you to be here. And they said, oh, it's just been a mix-up, and they went.
So, did they not wait until the social workers turned up?
Yeah, just to get clarification. Because obviously everything we say, they just disbelieve, and then they went, and Ty then went into care the day after, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And then we sort of went home, and at the time we used to see him 2 hours, no, 3 hours.
3 hours.
Twice a week. And it was really weird when it started, because we used to have to see him in a staff canteen at social work offices.
In the canteen?
Yeah. At the beginning.
They had nowhere else.
They have nowhere else. They didn't have any facilities. And then it progressed to a park because the weather got warmer and we had totally unsupervised contact. And then that progressed us travelling from Muirkirk, where we lived, to Kilmarnock, because that's where Ty was, to pick him up.
Off the carer.
Off the carer.
So you went to the carer's house to
go?
No, we had to go to the headquarters of the authority to pick him up in the car park. Bearing in mind, from Muirkirk to Kilmarnock, it's a 30-mile journey. So we used to have to drive 30 miles to pick Ty up, turn around, drive 30 miles back home, have contact at home. Then a social worker would come out and do a spot check, which lasted all of 10 minutes, if she could be bothered to turn up. And then we'd have to drive 30 miles back to drop him off again.
So that in itself must have been stressful for Ty, even when he was a little child.
Yeah.
Spending so much time in the car and not being able to relax with his parents like normal children.
We brought that up, didn't we, about him spending too much time in the car seat, because you held him one day and he was in the shape of a car seat. You know how it sort of buckets, he was just sat in your hands, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Curled. And they went, oh no, it's fine, doesn't matter, won't harm him. But I remember going back a few years, they said that babies are best left straight, laid flat, so their spines don't curve, because it can affect people in later life. and yet he just seemed to always be in a car seat. But I was nitpicking.
They said that was nitpicking, didn't they?
Yeah.
Every time we say anything, we're nitpicking.
Yeah. We're not concerned parents, we're just nitpicking.
So whilst we're on the subject of concern then, excuse me, there was a period, I understand, for about 6 months where every fortnight Ty would have a different bruise or scratch or burns to his hands.
Yeah, yeah, burns to both hands actually. He touched radiator pipes and blistered in there and there on both hands. And basically we were overreacting when we queried and complained about it. And they didn't even seek medical attention. The best he got was a pharmacist, and that was it, and that was acceptable. And when I complained, and I even took the authority to a complaints review panel over it, and I got told by them that I was still nitpicking.
So just to summarise that, over a 6 month period, there were 12 different bruises thereabouts.
Yeah.
Bruises, scratches and abrasions, things like that, and burned hands.
Yeah.
And none of these issues were reported to a doctor?
No, nothing. They've never reported anything. Not a thing.
And you've got photographic evidence of this?
Yeah. You know, if anybody else was to do it, it would be neglect.
Just one of those?
Just one, yeah. The burns on their own would be neglect.
Mm. If we'd had him at home and he'd done that in our care, they would have had him straight out of the house, saying that we were being neglectful. But like you said before, isn't it, that the carers are just licensed child abusers?
Yeah.
And they can get away with it.
That's it. They're licensed to, aren't they? That they can't do any wrong in the eyes of the authority because they work for them.
Mm.
They can't take their own to court, can they, for something that they've not done right? Because then they'd get hauled up for not training them properly or something like that. So it doesn't matter what they do. It's all good.
So all of this initially was based on a lie anyway. There's no reason whatsoever for them to keep your child.
No, no. The originally, they used one excuse and one excuse only, and that is because I have a conviction against a child from a previous marriage, which I didn't commit and I didn't cause the injury. Social work compiled a risk assessment, a comprehensive risk assessment at that, and their own notes, which is there by Graham Matuzak, actually says to view as innocent.
And your former wife has admitted that it was her who...
Yeah.
Who assaulted your other son.
Yeah.
But and that's gone on record, but they've taken no notice of it.
Taken no notice of it.
So you're an innocent man, an innocent couple. You've had your child taken off you for no good reason.
Yeah.
And nobody's prepared to help you.
No. No.
Until now, when we contacted, Nick Griffin, wasn't it, and we got put onto you. And we've had more help from your party than anybody else, and it's nice to have the support there and somebody to turn to when things drive you crazy. You know, you've been a fantastic listener when you've had phone calls at stupid o'clock and I was just ranting down the phone at you. You know, for somebody just to listen and try and advise and stuff's been a real help, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Especially for you, because your head goes over everything, but you know, for what you and Nick and everybody's done, it's thank you.
Well, you're welcome, and this is just the start of it, Nicky, because Nick Griffin, Northwest MEP, is determined to do something about it because he knows this is one of many thousands, but this is on his patch.
Yeah.
And he's not at all happy that this sort of thing is happening on his patch, and he's determined to do something about it, as we all are. Mm. And hopefully this expose will help the situation and expose those people who are behaving like this.
I hope so. I mean, it is widespread. I mean, you've only got to look on the internet. Mm. It's central government actually pay bonuses. Well, I view them as a bonus, but they pay some large sums of money to authorities for taking X amount of children each year into care. And in 2008, 2009, it was 20,000. It's a lot.
And you were saying just Merseyside alone?
2.5 million.
£2.5 million pounds in 1 year?
In 1 year.
As a reward for stealing people's children?
Yeah. Yeah.
The Pied Piper of Merseyside, no doubt, then, eh?
Yeah.
So your situation is East Ayrshire Council in Scotland.
Yeah.
And they don't seem to care what people say, because a week after they took Ty into care, and I use the term loosely, by the way, care, their own person did a risk assessment yep. on you both.
Yeah.
And he, who's obviously an experienced person in that field, he has said that you're viewed as innocent.
Yeah. Yeah, and they did. It's not even one person that compiled the risk assessment, it's two. It's Graham and Jackie Blair. And Jackie Blair, since this was compiled, has gone on to actually train social workers. Mm. And it's actually documented on the internet that she's been promoted and she now trains up-and-coming social workers. So she's highly respected in her field, but not highly respected enough by her managers, I suppose, to...
take any notice of her report?
Yeah. Which says that Ty should be at home.
She said, didn't she, on one of the visits, that what was written previously about you is not true. You are not the person that they that what's been said about you. And that we should have Ty home soon. And that was back in 2009. And then they started raising the word adoption. And she went that he should not be adopted, he should be returned to us and she'll bat our corner. And then at one of the next hearings, obviously her managers had spoken to her and threatened her with losing her job or something, because she totally went, he should be adopted.
Completely the reverse of yep. what she said before.
Yep.
This is Jackie Blair.
Yep.
You know. And what happened to Graham Matusak?
He got replaced. He got put on somewhere
else. Moved, didn't he? Yeah, never saw him again.
We've gone through 12 social workers. Every time they say that Ty should be coming home, they're removed. And in the early days, when we were having hearings that they have, it was just us and the social worker at hearing. And then when they went to adoption, and we complained to social work because all these people were saying Ty should come home and he wasn't coming home. So we literally put in a complaint. And from that day onwards, every time there's a hearing now, it's the social worker and their manager that comes to the hearing. Which, when we've spoken to solicitors, isn't it, they've all said, well, managers don't normally come.
It's overkill, isn't it?
Yeah.
That they're it feels like we're going into a, what's the word? A battle, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It's like us two against this horde of people, because you get the manager, the social worker, anyone that's been in on contact, and then the carers themselves. So you've got all these people having a go at you, and it's just us two sat there, and you've got obviously the three magistrates or whatever. And it just feels like we're going into a lion's den.
Who are actually employed by the authority?
Yeah.
Whereas initially, when all these different social workers that you formed a relationship with, they could see that you're just normal people.
Yeah.
You're not villains, you know, you're not bad people.
No.
And they were presumably putting those reports in, but somebody somewhere didn't want those reports to continue.
One of them actually turned around to us, didn't she? Because we got really confused and we were talking to her. We got on well with them all. We're always polite. That's who we are, you know. And it was always noted that we were polite and courteous, and then it changed, and we were aggressive and everything else. But we asked her and about it, and she said that if we were having, because we were having contact at home, Ty was coming to the family home, then they were looking at returning him, because you do not have contact at home if they're going to not return him. So it was at home and also just out of home with no explanation whatsoever. Mm. Same with the supervised and unsupervised, have seen him, you know, 3 hours twice a week in a park with not one social worker around. No harm come to our son. And yet they decided that, no, that's not on. We're going to make sure there's somebody there all the time and cut it down, so.
And also, from that point on, you weren't allowed to take him unsupervised to a park.
No.
You could only speak to him in a room. And the first room was seven foot by seven foot.
Yeah.
So there's...
It was. And all that was in the room was a kitchen sink on that bit there. There was a two-seater sofa there and a little coffee table there, and that was it.
Oh, baby changing.
Oh, the baby changing.
Those ones with the bath and everything in all in one thing.
And that was it.
How old was Ty then?
8 months.
8 months old.
8 months old.
In a room 7 foot by 7 foot.
Yeah.
With a sink, so there's actually less space, and there's a table in there, so there's less
there was like a kiddie rug on the floor, but it was black. It was as dirty as dirt could be.
Really?
Yeah, and there was no way he was going to put him down on that.
They wondered why we wouldn't let him crawl have you seen the state of the floor? I'm sorry, how many kids and people walk through that?
And we used to go in there, wasn't it? And we'd end up, it was winter. It's like minus 15 degrees outside in Scotland. And we're wrapped up to the hilt, and it's like you're taking your coat off, your jumper, your shirt and everything, right down to a t-shirt, because it's 85 degrees in this room.
With no ventilation.
With no ventilation whatsoever, because there's a window with a shutter down it, and they lock it all off in the winter. So you can't even open the window to get fresh air in there.
Because we complained about the state of the rug, the window not being able to open, and you couldn't have the door open because it was basically into like the reception area. So anybody coming in would see, or, you know, and you didn't want that. You wanted the privacy of seeing your son. And we just got told that we were nitpicking.
Yeah.
Everything nitpicking. You know.
The fact that if you worked for an employer, you wouldn't be allowed to work in that sort of temperature. Mm. So, but you're expected to sit in.
Nor would you be allowed to stay in a 7x7 room.
No.
You know, two people and a little baby.
Mm.
And a third body.
Oh, they were with you as well?
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So it was supervised. So there was three adults.
Yeah.
And a little baby in a room 7x7.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah.
Because we wouldn't put him on the floor, one of us used to sit on the floor, didn't we? So he could have like the extra seat on the chair. I mean, he wasn't really crawling. He was a late crawler, wasn't he?
He basically walked before he could crawl.
Yeah. But they started saying that we wouldn't let him do anything. Well, I'm sorry, but until there's somewhere clean for him to go, I'm not putting him on the floor.
Mm.
You wouldn't, you know, even if you took him to a toddler group, the places are clean, you know, you'd think that at least clean the rug every now and again. They did actually clean it, and we went in there after they cleaned it, and it was wet.
Yeah.
So you still couldn't go on the floor because it's wet. And then you're having to close the door with heat and no ventilation in a wet, damp atmosphere.
Mm.
So, yeah.
So you moved on from there to a bigger room.
Oh, yeah. 20 foot by 30 foot. No windows.
Still no windows.
No windows at all.
And still supervised?
Yeah. Yeah. It's not even really kitted out for appropriate children of
his age,
because there's nothing to climb on in there. I mean, the room's big enough, you'd think with it being what they call a contact room, there'd be like a slide or something for them to play on and climb up and that, but there's not. There's a sofa, and then there's a couple of ride-on toys, and then it's all books, isn't it?
Yeah.
And puzzles.
But because he's inquisitive, which any 2.5-3-year-old's going to be, he wants to play with everything, no matter if it's not age-related. But so because he wanted to look and investigate, and it's not appropriate, we're letting him play with inappropriate toys for his age.
But so, they put them in the room.
Yeah,
and I went to the toilet, and while I was gone, the social work, the support worker had said to Ty that, because Ty had wanted a specific game out of the cupboard to play with, hadn't he? Wait till Daddy comes back and ask Daddy to get it. So I came back into the room, and he went about this toy, well, this game. And
it was a board game, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I think it was Kaplunk or something.
Yeah. And I went, oh, right. And I went, well, that's a bit out of his range. If he wants to play with it, play with it. So I went, fine, if you're saying so, fine. And that was the support worker. Then the next minute, the social worker writes in a report that we're allowing him to play with toys that are inappropriate for him.
But the social worker wouldn't make that decision themselves, him or herself.
No.
She waited for you to come back.
Yeah, the support worker said it was fine, but the social worker that's in charge of the case wrote in a report that it was inappropriate after her co-worker had said it was fine.
Right.
They'll say one thing and do it up to your face, and then in a report they'll put the total opposite to make you look out the bad person all the time.
So they're outright liars, aren't they? Apart from lying in the first place to steal your child.
Yeah.
So that they can gain money from the state. It defies all logic apart from money grabbing. That's the only thing you can see. There's no other reason why they would do these things, is there?
No. I mean, all you've got to do, anybody that's got a computer, just put into the browser, forced adoption, it opens up a whole new world.
And you're saying there's about 20,000 children that have been taken?
Yeah. Yeah.
I understand there's a support group.
There is.
You know, that's where parents involved in this situation can chat about what they're going to do together. Let's hope we can set up a campaign for that support group to represent everybody rather than just those ones who've heard about it so far. Because a lot of people haven't got a computer.
No,
they haven't.
I
don't know if it's just me, but because your child gets taken from you, you fall into that well, I don't want to say anything because people will think you've done something wrong. So therefore it gets brushed under the carpet and then people just keep their mouth shut and try and struggle along.
It's not only that, it's not okay, it's also what will other people perceive of you.
Yeah.
You know, are they going to start a hate campaign against you because a child's involved? They don't, it's not a case of getting to know the full situation, facts and history. It's a case of a child, so they automatically think the worst, that, you know, you must have done whatever you're supposed to have done and everything else. You know, there's always, there's a stigma around it because it is a child. So you are very cautious about who you say, what you say, and it makes you very guarded and, in a way, isolates you because you're scared to mix with other people because you've got that going on in your head. And it could be, I don't know, birthday, Christmas, around that time when you're going to miss them the most. Mm-hmm. And yet you can't explain it to the people you're with. And then they're going to think you're just being offhanded or ignorant or that, you know, because you're coming across as not enjoying yourself like you should, or because you've got other things to worry about. You know, they may have their kids with them, but you haven't. So it just makes that little bit harder to mix with other people that, you know, don't know the full situation. But even the closest people you don't say everything to, because you just don't know how they're going to react.
Yeah, I can understand that.
You feel very isolated.
Because it is a very delicate subject. And, and people, most people out there don't know that children are being kidnapped by the state. And when you say it out loud, it sounds so outrageous that people wouldn't believe it. Like the fella from the Scottish Sun slamming the phone down on you. Because he says, well, that just doesn't happen in Britain. But it does. And it's happening to thousands and thousands of people. Yet nobody's prepared to do anything about it.
No.
Say nobody. Nick Griffin is prepared to do something about it in the BNP. And also, in fairness, Brian Gerrish, who you've been in touch with, is, you may not have seen any evidence of it yet, but he's doing work on your behalf as well. So between the two of them and our party and BNPTV, we're hoping to expose the truth of all of this so that you can get Ty back. And it's ironic that we're in the Queen's Diamond Jubilee year. She's been on the throne for 60 years. And her official birthday is the 21st of April, which just happens to be Ty's birthday. So I wonder if she could make a gesture to release one of the children from this bondage for a Diamond Jubilee.
It just seems to be that anybody in authority just doesn't want to know. They don't care. Their little world's safe. That's all they care about, I think. And they've got enough money in the bank. Sod all the lonely people below them. You know, let them get on with their own lives, basically. That's how I feel, you know.
Every man for himself.
Yeah. As long as it doesn't interfere with them, they don't care. So.
Yeah, I think there's an awful lot of that about nowadays. It's been instilled into people. And I think it started, my experience of that happening was under Thatcher, who, you know, back in the 1970s, instilled a very selfish attitude. And the people since then have made it 10 times worse. You know, and if you're not allowed to think about your fellow countrymen and women, you know, you just got to look after number one and forget everyone else, and that's supposed to be real life. Well, sorry, that's not
the case.
What we believe in, you know, we're supposed to love our neighbour and help out there, help each other out. So, tell us about, you were living in a village called Muirkirk, which is near Kilmarnock. And then you were having to drive 30 miles to collect Ty.
Yeah.
And then drive 30 miles to take him back to your house. And then when you'd had your time with him, drive another 30 miles to take him back home again.
Yeah, and then turn around and drive back home again.
So, and now in the last, year or two, you've been living in Blackpool.
Yeah.
And you've only been allowed to see him for a couple of hours one day a week.
Yeah. When we lived in Muirkirk, they used to give us petrol money because I was out of work. And we'd travel. It was a 120-mile round trip, wasn't it, every time we go to see him. And they'd give us some petrol money. Then when we moved back to England, and I was still out of work to start with, it was your decision to move back to England, so therefore we're not paying you any petrol money. So we used to have to put it ourselves, which you will anyway because it's your son, mm. you know, but we drive all the way up there, and we could get all the way up there and then get told, well, you're not seeing him today. So we'd have to turn around and drive all the way back.
He doesn't want to see you.
Yeah. And they'd not give you like an hour or 30 minutes notice. It was literally 5 minutes before you'd see him, and it's, you're not seeing him today. So you'd have to turn around and drive all the way back. And it was 4 hours each way.
So it was, we were just getting up to the car park one time, weren't we? We get the phone call.
Yeah.
So you just turn around.
It gets worse as well, doesn't it? Because last October, they then told you that they wouldn't be able, you wouldn't be allowed to see him at all.
No, that's right. They last 23rd of October last year was the last time we saw him.
And what was the reason for that?
They say he doesn't want to come and see us.
And they've had a rational conversation with a 2.5-year-old.
He's showing signs of distress.
No, he said at one point that he doesn't want to see us.
Yeah.
We have that in a text message from them.
Yeah.
This is what they've said?
That's what they've said. They've had a conversation with him and he's told them that he doesn't want to see us. Yeah, when we've seen him, yeah, he can say words, but you can't have a conversation with him as they're saying that you can have a conversation with him.
No.
I mean, I know he's intelligent and good, but...
But now
he's not Einstein, you know, and even Einstein, he didn't develop until he was 15 or 16 or something.
But now he's showing great signs of distress or something that whenever we're mentioned.
And this is your fault?
Yes.
Yeah, but
it's not the situation
yeah.
of him being in an enclosed environment.
But, I don't know how you'd say it, but it's not meant to be funny, but the ironic thing out of it is he shows signs of distress when he's coming to see Mummy and Daddy. So they stop us seeing him, but then they ask for a photo of us to put in his room.
Hmm. It is a bit of a contradiction in terms that, because it sounds on one hand like they don't want him to even know you.
Yeah, that's what it is. Because they want to put him up for adoption, they want to break all contact that we have so that he doesn't have...
So they must be... Ty must be asking about you both.
Oh, apparently no.
They say no, but I say yeah, he does.
Well, for them to concede that they want to put a photograph of you in his room would suggest to me that he's asking for you.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's the halfway stage.
Yeah. I mean, when we used to see him, and they used to bring him to us when we were at the park, and that we'd sort of park one side of the car park, and they'd have to drive all the way round. And when he'd clock us, he'd be waving and smiling, and he'd be really happy to see us and couldn't get out of the car quick enough.
Mm.
Going back was a different matter. If he was in our car, he'd create merry hell and not want to go back. And it'd break our heart every time because he'd literally be screaming, no, 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 no. Literally climbing around the car to try and get away from you. But that obviously never happened because they say that it wouldn't.
So you haven't seen him for months since last 23rd of October? Okay, so we need a plan of action for what we're going to do to help you get him back. What we would suggest is that Nick Griffin will be writing some letters and making a certain amount of noise in certain areas. I would suggest that you write to David Cameron again for a third time, you know, and don't allow him to sit on the fence. And also Nick Clegg is a partner. Strange relationship. And the Queen. I know you've written to the Queen twice already, but I would write to her and say to her and remind her that Ty was born on her birthday. And couldn't she possibly have some compassion in her Diamond Jubilee to do something about it? And at least acknowledge that these children are being stolen and kidnapped from their parents. So... That's what I suggest you do in the meantime, and Nick will take it on board as well, and Brian will, as I mentioned earlier. But we can't be too despondent, you know. We've got to be hopeful, and you know, you seem like a nice couple as well. So I'm sure you look forward to getting Ty Ethan back again.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, you never sit on your bum anyway, do you? You always find someone to write to, or
that's it. I mean, it's like the
or...
latest. Events. Well, they said that he's going out for adoption because we never agreed to do a risk assessment. Yeah, we have the risk assessment, so...
It'll be seen if we can write to an ombudsman or see what the solicitor can do.
Oh, I wrote to the ombudsman. I took them to a complaints review panel, and they sided with them, and then I could go to the ombudsman. So I took that view, and the ombudsman turned around and said, we can't get involved because it's social work. So you're up against...
Unbelievable. Right. Okay, and this is their own assessment here, as we've indicated before. So you've got it in writing that, you know, they've assessed you, and they've said you're fit parents to look after your child, but they still won't allow you to have him. You've also got photographic evidence of damage to tie, on bruises and cuts and abrasions, all of these things, yet nobody is allowing you to have any redress over it.
No.
Okay, so what I'd like you to do is just do a list of information for our benefit, if you would, so that Nick can just use them as one-liners, so that Nick can then use those and he can look into the deeper aspects of it and ask the questions and say, go on, let's have the child back, you know, hopefully before his third birthday, which is a month away.
Yeah.
But you never know, when people want to do things, they can do them very quickly.
Yeah.
Is there anything you'd like to say, both of you, before we wind up?
No, just thank you for helping.
And good luck to anybody else that's going through it.
Yeah.
Hopefully they find the help that they need.
Yeah, and you're more than welcome to get in contact.
Yeah. Okay, Jeff.
I have stacks of papers and pointing directions.
Can imagine. Thanks. All right, well, thanks very much for doing the interview.
Thank you.
Thanks, Nicky.